Hi, folks. Welcome back. Steve Malzberg with you. How many times have we heard from the left that Ronald Reagan wouldn't recognize this Republican Party? We even heard it from Bob Dole, unfortunately, that there'd be no place for Reagan in this party. Dole said he didn't recognize the Republican Party. But the fact of the matter is, as has been discussed also in this show, that it's JFK who wouldn't recognize the Democratic Party. And you don't have to go back that far to JFK to find those who wouldn't recognize the Democratic Party. It is not your father's Democratic Party. And in fact, according to our next guest, Michael Goodwin of the New York Post, he talks about how the party has no more centrists in it. And I couldn't agree more. Hello, Michael. Good to talk to you.
Hello, Steve. Thank you.
All right. So you talk about the fact that you heard a claim that the Democratic Party is at war, just like parts of the Republican Party might be described between the Tea Party and the establishment. And they were talking about the centrist Democrats battling the progressives. And you came to the conclusion, or you the exclamation, what centrist Democrats?
Yeah, they're the dodo birds of politics. They're extinct or darn close to it, and I go through a list of them to show that whether it's Hillary Clinton, Chuck Schumer, they've all folded their tents. They're no longer talking about defense as defense hawks. They're very much in sync with this president. You have Joe Lieberman, who was a defense hawk, essentially thrown out of the party because he continued to turn on the Iraq invasion, which he had supported. You've got the election of Bill de Blasio in New York. You've got the ascendancy of Elizabeth Warren in Massachusetts. And, of course, leading it all is Barack Obama, who I argue is the most radical president in modern times. I mean, he is far, far, far more liberal than George McGovern would have been in the 70s.
Oh, my God. Absolutely. You're so right. I'm glad you brought up McGovern. And, you know, you also allude in the piece to someone like Scoop Jackson. You mentioned Lieberman. And, of course,
Moynihan.
Yeah, talk about him. I mean, these were true blue. No one ever doubted their Democrat credentials. But these were people who were for, to one sense or another, strong moral values. They were for strong defense. They were for, tax cuts to one extent or another. Or at least they were more mainstream. The platform of the Democratic Party on a national level. And then you talk about de Blasio on a New York local level. My God, he is, a Marxist. I mean, he went to foreign countries to support Marxism.
Yes.
or Stalinism. I mean,
yes.
This guy is as wacky as it gets. So, I mean, there's no way that they could claim that they are centrist or in the middle or even anything like the people we're talking about.
Right. And this idea that there's a battle, and the battle's over. The centrists have lost. They have no power in this party. And what's amazing, Steve, is if you look at President Obama, every time he gets in a fix, he doesn't try to build a bridge to draw in the center of the country. He pushes harder on the left. He always goes back to the base. I mean, last week, for example, he's in trouble over Obamacare. Where does he go? To Chris Matthews of MSNBC. That's hardly somebody who's going to build you a bridge to the other 60% of the country, but that's not his interest. His interest is in revving up the base and in keeping the base intact, and no desire to reach across to the rest of the country.
Right, and Michael, he alerted us to the fact that despite the fact that people can't get jobs and despite the Obamacare debacle, which goes beyond the website, from now on, the focal point of his presidency is going to be economic inequality and injustice. I mean, that came out of left field, literally.
But that is precisely what it's all about. That this has been the largely unspoken agenda. And what happens with him, it's very strange, because normally when somebody, as I say, a politician gets kind of trapped into a small corner, they try to enlarge the field. They try to build a bigger tent, bring more people into it, let more people relate. His is the opposite. His is always to kind of double down, triple down, stick on the same theme, push harder on those themes, make them more radical in the hopes of exciting those already on his side,
right,
or reminding them of why they should be on,
right,
his side. Never expanding it.
No, why we should be divided and the other people are bad and we're good. We're talking,
yes,
to Michael Goodwin of the New York Post here on the Steve Malzberg Show. We got time for one more point you made, and I love it, perhaps above everything else, and that is how Al Sharpton is the new MLK, Martin Luther King Jr., of today's Democrats and left.
Yes. I mean, it is astounding to me, but Al Sharpton has been in the White House constantly. He both tells the president what he thinks and then carries the president's message back to his radio and TV shows. I mean, he's doing the same thing with de Blasio. De Blasio is a Sharpton acolyte. So Sharpton has more power than Martin Luther King ever had. And this, to me, is mind-boggling.
Yeah, and you know,
I mean,
and you know why it's mind-boggling? I'm sorry, Michael. It's mind-boggling because it's not in spite of what he did and who he has been. It's because of what he's done and who he's been.
Well, look, that may be, but to me, it is mind-boggling because I think he is a totally divisive figure.
Oh, absolutely.
And so, again, if you're trying to reach across, unite the country, build a consensus, look, I'm not suggesting President Obama or any candidate or any president of any party could get 100% support.
No, Michael, we're out of time, but your key word there was if you're trying, and I don't believe they are.
It's consensus.
Michael,
you aim it for 60-65%.
Speak to you again, Michael. Thank you very much. Michael Goodwin, ladies and gentlemen, New York Post, Steve Malzberg Show.